So two of the biggest sporting events around the world happens every 2 years. One is the Summer Olympics, which is going to be this year. And I think it's being held in Brazil, right? Brazil, we got to get it right in Brazil.
You got it.
And the other one is a World Cup that happens 2 years from now. And that's going to be in Russia, is what I believe. 2018 will be in Russia. 2022 is going to be in Qatar. Okay. So always keep this in mind. Whenever we have Summer Olympics, is election time in America on who will be the next president. So a lot of times people call me and message me and say, hey, Patrick, just out of curiosity, man, I'm so, you know, curious. Are you a Republican? Are you a Democrat? Are you a Libertarian? Are you independent? Who are you voting for president? What do you think is going on, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? So I'm just going to give you my thoughts right now on how to process for a candidate. And you can, I'm really curious to really want to hear from you on your thoughts about the subject we talked today. Sometimes people aren't into politics. Sometimes people are not into politics. And what I will tell you is, I think maturity, I know you know a lot of people say there's a couple of things you should never talk about. Never talk about politics and never talk about religion. You should never do it. Well, I mean, it just so happens to be two of the most interesting things to talk about. By the way, if you hear a lot of background noise, we are doing construction next door in our office, so they're building out the cubicles. But let me get into it. Okay, so on the left side, you have two candidates. On the left side, you have Bernie Sanders, and you have Hillary Clinton. Let's go through each one of them, my opinion, so you can kind of hear what I think about these guys. So Bernie Sanders is a man that whatever he says, he really believes. Okay, so he's not the typical professional politician like maybe a Hillary who is known how to play all the games because she has the most experience. Bernie is the one that whatever, visualize him as, remember the kid in school who was all about making sure the right thing happens to everybody, and he was like, this is not fair, that's not fair, we shouldn't do this, and he really believes it. That's really him. So I foresee Bernie actually being somebody that has probably had the most consistency. His belief system has probably been the most consistent over the last 40, 50, 60 years. He hasn't had a lot of changes. Probably 40, 50, 60 years, he's been about the same person. Now, what are his beliefs? So one, I respect the fact that a man really believes in what he says. There's respect in a man that actually believes in what he says, which he does. But his belief system is a belief system of wanting to increase taxes and wanting to have us pay for college education for kids, which means taxes will go up for you and I. And a lot of the programs that he wants to come out with is for taxes for the higher end to go to a whole different level than ever before. And the world of socialism is something that is a very a noble concept. It's a very noble concept when you hear people say, generally a lot of younger crowd likes to believe in such things as socialism and communism because it's an easy thing to sell to people. You know, the story is very easy to sell to people. Rich people are greedy. All they want to do is make money and take advantage of the poor, and they step on them and they do this and they do that. And it's easy to get an 18, 19, 20, 21-year-old to buy that concept. So it's not hard to do that. It's very easy to sell that concept. But America going back to a European concept where if you look around the world right now on who has contributed for the most jobs around the world, no country has created more jobs around the world than America has. Not one country has created more jobs around the world than America has. And America has 41 roughly million immigrants living here. And number two country is 11 million. And we're not the biggest country for population, yet we have this many people living here. They're not coming here for socialism. People from other countries are not coming here because they want Social Security or benefits. People are coming here because they want freedom of religion, because they're sick and tired of being afraid to say, I'm a Christian, I'm a Catholic, I'm a Muslim, I'm a this. They're afraid of saying that. They're afraid of doing that. They're coming to America because of a freedom of assembly. They want to be able to sit around and talk to an audience and give their opinions. Freedom of opinion, you know, whatever you want to say, freedom of speech, whatever you want to say, you can say. You can disagree with me and curse me out on the YouTube channel. You have all the right to. Totally fine. You can do that. No one's going to fire you, terminate you, write you up, get you arrested. It's not going to happen. You can say all the things you want about presidents. You like them, you don't like them. Free enterprise is a big part of it. People can come here and make money. And all of those are generally against socialism. Socialism is not about free enterprise. It's the step right before communism. And one of the interesting things is with socialism is, when you typically ask people what socialism is, rarely do they know what the economical system of socialism is. And why is it that, you know, it, always look at it this way. This is the best way to look at it. You know, if you look at coaches, sports, always look at it this way. It's very simple. To me, politics and sports are very similar. Look at which coach produced the most coaches. Just look at that. What coach produces the most coaches that went out there and became successful? Okay? Then look at coaches that never won and look at coaches that won. But look at what they produce. What are they producing themselves? You will generally be able to tell what that produces, what product it produces. Communism produced 20 million people being killed in Russia. Communism hasn't produced an environment where people want to live in. A lot of people will say, well, you don't know what communism's all about. You've never lived in communism. You may have lived in. Some people have lived in it and they like it, but you haven't been in capitalism to know the difference, right? And some people will say, well, you know, socialism this. And look, socialism hasn't produced products or companies or jobs that has positively affected the world. Communism has killed tens of millions of people, and capitalism has purely created competition, which is something most people don't like. So Bernie Sanders is purely a socialistic individual. So when you vote for that, know that America's going away. It's probably the only candidate that will dramatically change the direction that America's going towards. Now, Hillary Clinton on the other side, if you want to talk about the person with the most amount of experience in politics, I would probably put Hillary above everybody. I would put her above Jeb Bush as an experience, although Jeb just came out of the entire thing. Jeb has probably been around it longer as a kid. He watched his father and his grandfather and his brother, so he's been around. I'd probably put those two together, but knowing how to play the game better, she is 100-fold better than Jeb Bush. Jeb Bush is a nice man, but you know, when it comes down to a street fight, he gets knocked out every single time. When it comes down to a street fight, Hillary knows how to hold her own. She knows how to play the word game. And she knows when she speaks to different audiences on what audience this wants to hear, what this audience wants to hear. She has the biggest backing from Wall Street that's definitely backing her up. So access to money to be able to do commercials, she's going to have a lot of access to that, to play the campaigns. She knows the power play games better than all the other candidates. Maybe Ted Cruz is going to be good in that, and maybe Trump is going to be good in that. I don't know how well Rubio is going to play in the power games, although I think he's shown a little bit of a glimpse. Maybe he's got some good advisors now that are giving him feedback on playing a little bit more aggressive. But Hillary's got the biggest experience, weight, money backing her to be able to do that. Now, here's the only challenge. The only challenge is it's not like she's crushing Bernie. It's not like she has that big of a lead. Bernie came back out of nowhere. Nobody thought Bernie was going to have a chance. And, you know, he's losing 47 to 53. He's not losing 31 to 69. He's losing 47 to 53, which means there are a lot of people that Democrats would rather have Bernie than Hillary. And there are some Democrats that will never vote for Hillary because they say she's just lied too many times. And the Benghazi is going to come over. You know, that's going to be definitely brought up many times. And, you know, her email is going to come up. And I know some people will say, well, it's the Republicans. We are playing the games, et cetera, et cetera. Could be. I don't know if it is or not. All I know is it's going to come up. So that's on that side. So it looks like liberals are probably going to lean more towards Hillary because they don't think Bernie can truly drive everything. Although Bernie is getting all his money from $5 donations, $20 donations, $100 donations. He has a lot more donations than Hillary does as number of people donating. But Hillary has more money that she's getting because of her clout with her husband, Bill Clinton, been around for a while and, you know, having more experience politically. So now let's look at the complete opposite side on the Republican side. You have Marco Rubio, who Marco Rubio is somebody who extremely well-spoken, very, very presentable, prolific speaker, good at debating, very passionate, is probably the person he's probably the most charismatic candidate out of everybody, more charismatic than Hillary, than Bernie, than Ted, definitely than Ted, than Trump. He's very charismatic. Likeable. He's a guy that both the left and the right can like. I think he's Hispanic, so he's going to be able to connect with the Hispanic community, and he actually knows how to speak Spanish. He is somebody who is fully in that space himself, and so comes from a very important state, Florida, which Florida is going to help him out when it comes on, depending if he wins. If he doesn't win that state, kiss it goodbye for himself. But he comes from Florida, which is an important state, And, you know, just somebody that has a possibility of being a candidate. He's probably, a lot of people say he's eventually going to be a president, whether it's going to be this time or not, he's going to be president. But where's the criticism come from? The criticism is he's a one-term senator, which President Obama was also a one-term senator. So if they bring that up, he can always go back to that, which he's going to. If they say, well, he's only a one-term senator, and then he's going to say, well, look how President Obama was. He was a one-term senator, so the liberals are not going to have an argument for that because the most recent president was that. They're going to say he doesn't show up when the decisions are being made. He'll have a comeback for that. He got a lot of Jeb Bush's voters and money that went from Bush to him, which is good. It's going to be interesting when John Kasich and Ben Carson drop out, where that money and percentage of support is going to go. You saw Chris Christie just teamed up with Donald Trump, so that'll be interesting. So Rubio could be a candidate. Especially now that he's trying to swing for the fences. Then you have Ted Cruz. Ted Cruz is someone that I had a chance to meet a few months back in D.C. Mar, I think you did as well. Yeah. We went to D.C. together. Yeah. And he is probably the sharpest cat out of everybody. He probably has read every single power book in the world. It's what it feels like when you hear him. He can tear apart an opponent in a smaller setting very well. If you're a conservative, he's the biggest conservative candidate out of everybody. Very strong Christian himself. His father's a pastor. He's got a big loyal following. People like him. People either love him or hate him. People don't generally like him. Generally, they don't like him. They love him or they hate him. He's not a guy that's like Clinton was at least liked by Republicans. Reagan was liked by Democrats, but people just don't like Cruz. They love him or they hate him. It's the type of a guy he is. He's like Glenn Beck. That's why Glenn Beck supports him. On the negative side, he's kind of flip-flopped a little bit with his campaign. He's become a politician himself on the campaign side, and it's been interesting to see what's going to happen with him, because if he loses Texas, he loses the whole thing. I don't know what's going to happen, because I think Texas is either today or on Monday. We'll find out with Texas. Everyone's here right now. Marco Rubio was here this morning just talking smack about Trump the entire morning. And then, so we'll see what happened with Cruz. You know, I don't know what's going to happen with Cruz. I just don't know. He thinks he's Reagan. To me, there is nothing about his communication style that's a Reagan-ish type of style. I think Rubio, anytime he tries to add a little bit of humor, is probably more like Reagan on his communication style than is Ted Cruz. Ted Cruz, to me, comes across like a very, very shrewd, intelligent attorney that you don't want to go up against. That's who he comes across to me. So that's Cruz. Then we have Trump. Trump is the biggest market out of everybody. He doesn't have to take anybody's money, because all he does is make one tweet that's so controversial. MSNBC, Fox, CNN. ABC, everybody calls him for an interview, and he gets on interview, and instantly 50 million people hear what he has to say. So he doesn't need to campaign anywhere. We reached out to Hope Hicks, his campaign manager. We reached out to Trump. We'd had, you know, conversations with them about doing something. The conversation always goes back to, you know, viewership and what can we do. And we said, we'll get to 10 million. And, you know, we were this close to us doing the interview. And the next thing you know, he makes the comments about Muslims, and you know, everybody on TV wanted him, so we didn't have a chance to meet with Trump ourselves. So, but Trump, look, biggest marketer, biggest name. People liked him before him running for president. He's a strategist. He's a salesman. He's a closer. He's a winner. He knows how to make money. He has a lot of great contacts that, you know, if this guy picks up New York, which Chris Christie from the Jersey governor just endorsed him. So if he gets New York, it's bonkers if he gets New York. And he may, because he knows a lot of strong, powerful people in New York that are liberals and Republicans that may endorse him. And he's probably the guy that if crisis were to continue, if ISIS or more attacks like that were to happen around the world or in America, the voters are probably going to lean towards having somebody like that that's not afraid to go out there and attack. You know, people don't like people like that during peacetime, but people trust people like Trump during a wartime. He's a wartime leader is what I think he is. He does better in pressure type of situations. You're not worth, you know, multiple billions of dollars. I mean, he's not worth 10.9, but he's only worth 3 billion. He's a billionaire if it's 3 billion or 11 billion. Who cares between the 3 billion and 11 billion? The guy's a billionaire. And so on both sides, But on the other side, that when you look at why some people may not want to vote for him is track record, personal life, women, what he's done with some people he's fired and got the government lobbyists to push him out and, you know, push people out of the places that he wanted to buy. And so I would just assume if the argument sometimes comes that the liberals want him as the nominee because there's so much dirt on him that's going to come back when he does get the nomination that no one's yet bringing out, because they know the moment it really starts and the Republicans choose Trump as a nominee, there's so much dirt that they have on the left that they're just going to bring it out and it's going to annihilate Trump immediately. And he won't be able to respond to any of that stuff, the allegations. So we'll see what's going to happen. I mean, this is all a power play games at the highest level that these guys do. You just got to know that, you know, in the world of politics, you can't sit there and 100% put everybody in and just say, I'm in here. You got to kind of watch everybody closely. And nothing's really going to be finalized. This Tuesday is going to determine a lot. Whether it's going to be a broker convention, Super Tuesday, I think it's 13 states you're talking about. And then from there, we'll pretty much be able to know who the nominee is going to be on the left. It's most likely going to be Hillary, unless if something major drastically happens the next couple of days. And I'm talking drastic, like the FBI goes to a whole different level, or Benghazi goes to a whole different level, or the emails goes to a whole different level, or something else with Trump comes out. Trump's probably going to win it. So it looks like Trump, Rubio and Cruz are kind of teaming up to be able to say by this time. I would figure they would probably say, if I don't win Texas, I'm gonna go out and I'll endorse you and I'll be the VP and you go lead it and my percentage will go to you so it can beat Trump. And if I lose Florida, I'll go out and you take my votes and I'll endorse you and I'll be your VP, so I'll be the president. There's probably that strategy session going on right now. So it's gonna be very exciting next 48 to 96 hours to see what'll happen. But this is kind of the world of politics, like the world of sports. Lots of interesting things are taking place right now as we speak, and we will find out more closely the next few days on what will happen. So with that being said, that is my amateur analysis on politics that I have. I would be very curious to hear your thoughts on who you're leaning towards and why. And by the way, if you want to go off and curse each other out on there, you cannot, you know, I don't listen when you go to that point. I'm really curious to hear your thoughts, your educated thoughts. I'm really curious to process these issues with you. I don't pick anybody here. And I don't have anybody in mind that I'm endorsing or anybody in mind that I'm personally picking myself. It's still too early, but we'll see what happens between now and the next few days. The next few days is going to say a lot. But I would really be curious to hear your thoughts about who you're leaning towards politically. Some of you didn't even watch it past 30 seconds because you could care less about politics. You didn't even hear me saying this to you. That's totally fine. But this is for those of you weirdos that kind of like politics and you heard the whole thing. I want to hear from you. So post your comments on the bottom. And if you have any other friends that are also political and they have strong opinions, share this video with them. I'd be curious to hear their thoughts. And if you haven't subscribed to this channel, please do so. Take care. Bye-bye.